Blitz by Juliet Gardiner. Read by Catherine Harvey.
Preface. These are the facts. Observe them how you will. Forget for a moment the medals and the glory, the clean shape of the bomb designed to kill, and the proud headlines of the paper's story. Remember the walls of brick that 40 years had nursed to make a neat though shabby home. The impertinence of death ignoring tears that smashed the house and left untouched the dome. Bodies in death are not magnificent or stately. Bones are not elegant that blast has shattered. This sorry, stained and crumpled rag was lately a man whose like was made of little things that mattered. Now he is just a nuisance, liable to stink, a breeding ground for flies, a test tube for disease. Bury him quickly, and never pause to think what is the future like to men like these. People are more than places, more than pride. A million photographs record the works of Wren. A city remains a city, on credit from the tide that flows among its rocks, a sea of men. Ruthven Todd, these are the facts. Blitz is an abbreviation of the German word Blitzkrieg, meaning lightning war. It all too accurately describes Hitler's advance through Western Europe in May and June 1940, as Norway, then Holland, Belgium and France fell to the German forces within weeks. But it hardly seems appropriate for the almost continual aerial bombardment of the British Isles that started on the 7th of September 1940 and continued with little relief until the 10th of May 1941. Yet Blitz is the name by which these 8 months were known. It was a German word, and like lightning it came from the sky and could and did kill. Indeed, an air raid was, in many ways, like a terrible storm, the sky livid, rent by jagged flashes, obscured by black clouds rolling across it, or lit up by the reflected glow of fires, while the noise of bombs and guns echoed like the thunder of Mars, the god of war. The Blitz was the test of war for the British people. It touched everyone's lives. It mobilised the population, and in phrases that have become time-worn but are nevertheless true, put civilians on the front line and made the home front the battlefront. Dunkirk and the Battle of Britain, which preceded it, had essentially been military operations. The Blitz was total war. Its intensity and inescapability made it possible to call the Second World War the People's War, in which, in the words of the poet Robert Graves, a soldier cannot even feel that his rendezvous with death is more certain than that of his Aunt Fanny, the fire watcher. The Blitz was the war that everyone in Britain had been expecting and fearing since that warm Sunday morning in September 1939 when Neville Chamberlain had announced that Britain is now at war with Germany. Although there had been sporadic raids throughout the phony war that followed, it was not until almost exactly a year after the declaration that the Luftwaffe bombers arrived in force over London. Although England's capital was bombed more heavily and more continuously than anywhere else in the country, the Blitz was an attack on the whole United Kingdom. Few places escaped its direct effects, none its indirect ones. In January 1941, George Orwell wrote to the editors of the American journal The Partisan Review, to which he would contribute a London letter throughout the rest of the war. On that day in September, when the Germans broke through and set the docks on fire, I think few people can have watched those enormous fires without feeling that this was the end of an epoch. One seemed to feel that the immense changes through which our society has got to pass were going to happen there and then. But he went on to say that these feelings had been erroneous. To an astonishing extent, things have slipped back to normal. When all is said and done, one's main impression is the immense solidarity of ordinary people, the widespread yet vague consciousness that things can never be the same again, and yet, together with that, the tendency of life to slip back into the familiar pattern. Just a month later, Orwell was demanding that either we turn this war into a revolutionary war against privilege and influence and for equality and freedom, or we lose it. Neither happened. The equivocation and ambivalence of wanting change and wanting things to be as they had always been would persist, and politicians consistently declined to define Britain's war aims other than with the simple word, victory. Yet the Blitz was a defining moment in Britain's history. More than cityscapes were reconfigured in those 8 months. The attrition that had been anticipated for over a decade revealed both the incompetence of the authorities and their misunderstanding of the nature of such warfare and the needs of the people. But at the same time, it demonstrated their sometimes grudging, usually tardy, willingness to accommodate, compromise, and innovate. And perhaps, above all, eventually and imperfectly, to listen. To keep the people on side as much as possible, since it was recognised that civilian morale was vital in maintaining full-scale war production, and thus Britain's ability to prosecute the war at a time when victory was very far from assured. For this reason and others, the Blitz did prove to be a forcing house, a laboratory, the intense distillation of how an external threat could weld together a nation, while at the same time failing to resolve many of its tensions. The Blitz has given the British, politicians in particular, a storehouse of images on which to draw at times of crisis, the symbol of an indomitable nation, united in resolution. The true story is, of course, more nuanced and complicated than that, cross-hatched, as it must be, by the freight of the pre-war years, of differing experiences and expectations. There were thousands of examples of extreme bravery, fortitude, and selflessness. There was also a pervasive sense of exhaustion, uncertainty, and anxiety, and acts of selfishness, intransigence, and contumely. The words that best sum up the Blitz are probably endurance and defiance, and arising out of that, a sense of entitlement, that a nation that had been exhorted to take it could reasonably expect, when the war was finally over, to get some of it, in terms of greater equality, more employment, better housing, education, and life chances in general. In 1940, the use of the transitive verb to blitz signified to destroy by aerial bombardment. 70 years later, it is sometimes used to mean to deal with something energetically, to concentrate a lot of effort on something to get it done. Both meanings resonate in our understanding of the Blitz of 1940 to 1941 and its aftermath. Juliet Gardiner, June 2010. Before. I think it is well for the man in the street to realise that there is no power on earth that can prevent him from being bombed. Whatever people may tell him, the bomber will always get through. The only defence is in offence, which means that you have to kill more women and children more quickly than the enemy if you want to save yourselves. Conservative leader Stanley Baldwin, speaking in the House of Commons in 1932. Robert Baltrop was sitting on the roof of a Sainsbury's store in East London on Saturday, the 7th of September 1940. It was a warm, late summer afternoon, the rays of the sun stretching across the concrete rooftops. The air raid alert had just sounded, so Baltrop, who worked as a porter in the store, humping and cleaning and that sort of thing, had clambered out to take up his post on lookout duty. It wasn't bad being a watcher during these daytime warnings, sitting up there in the sunshine and smoking and watching the sky and looking down at the people going about their business as usual in the streets below. I wasn't really sure what I was watching for. Anything dangerous. Fires or bombs falling or planes getting near. And I don't really know what I could have done about it. I suppose I should have had to go down the steps and tell them in the shop that a bomb had fallen on them. The war was more than a year old by this time. It had been another lovely summer day when Hitler had failed to respond to Britain's ultimatum to withdraw German troops from Poland, and the Prime Minister, Neville Chamberlain, had broadcast to the nation at 11:15 on the 3rd of September 1939 to tell the British people that despite all my long struggle to win peace, this country is at war with Germany. Within minutes, the air raid sirens sounded, and Londoners scurried to take shelter. The war that everybody had been expecting had started. Only it hadn't. That first alert was a false alarm, and a metaphor for a long autumn, winter and spring of expectation and fearful anticipation. But until the summer of 1940, there was little sign of the Armageddon that had been feared, except at sea, where the Battle of the Atlantic, which would take the lives of more than 30,000 merchant seamen by 1945, had been raging since the outbreak of war, as Germany sought to stop supplies reaching Britain to enable her to keep fighting. By the late spring, hardly anyone was carrying their gas mask anymore. Shelters were filling up with water through disuse. A ban had been put on recruiting any more Air Raid Patrol, ARP, wardens, and many volunteers, bored with the endless waiting around, drinking cups of tea and playing darts, had resigned, since there didn't seem to be much for them to do other than act like martinets when any chink showed through the blackout curtains on their patch. Housewives were already beginning to feel fed up with rationing and the endless queuing and ingenuity in the kitchen that wartime shortages would demand. And more than 60% of the mothers and children who had joined the government's evacuation scheme on the eve of war had drifted back home to the cities by January 1940, no longer convinced that their homes would be bombed or their children killed, which had been the compelling reason for the exodus. It truly did seem to be a Boer war. All the regulations, restrictions and privations of wartime, with few of the dangers on the home front that would make them seem justified. On the 4th of April 1940, in what Winston Churchill, recalled to the Cabinet on the outbreak of war as First Lord of the Admiralty, thought was a speech of unusual optimism, Chamberlain sanguinely told a Conservative gathering that Hitler had missed the bus in seizing the offensive. 5 days later, German forces moved to occupy Norway and Denmark, and on the 10th of May, as Baltrup recalled, quite suddenly, the Germans invaded the Low Countries. There was the evacuation from Dunkirk, which the British press largely treated as a victory rather than a defeat. And on the 22nd of June, France signed an armistice with Germany. I remember at the Sainsbury's where I worked, somebody coming into the warehouse and almost with satisfaction rubbing his hands together and saying, "Well, we're on our own now." There was a feeling that we were in the war now, and a certain feeling of resolve about it. Dunkirk had its effect. There were Churchill's speeches, "We will fight on the beaches and we will never surrender," and very quickly daytime air raid warnings started. Again, there was this curious thing, just like at the beginning of the war. We expected the worst, and it didn't happen like that. We started getting air raid warnings by day and night. Sainsbury's agreed with the other shops round about they wouldn't put up the shutters immediately. But nothing happened, and people didn't go home. They stayed in the streets. So the gentleman's agreement between shopkeepers was dropped, and the shops started to open again, even when the air raid warnings went, and life went on through the summer. But they were getting nearer. Italy had entered the war in support of Germany on the 10th of June, and 6 days later, the French Prime Minister, Paul Reynaud, resigned, and Marshal Philippe Pétain, a military hero of the First World War, took over, and shortly afterwards signed an armistice, surrendering northern and western France to the advancing German forces. From across the Channel, Winston Churchill, Prime Minister since Chamberlain had resigned on the 10th of May, surveyed the defeated British Expeditionary Force evacuated from Dunkirk. And on the 18th of June, the 125th anniversary of the Battle of Waterloo, he addressed the House of Commons. Whatever had happened in France, he assured MPs, would make no difference to the resolve of Britain and the British Empire to fight on, if necessary, for years, if necessary, alone. He predicted that the Battle of Britain is about to begin, Upon this battle depends the survival of Christian civilization.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.